Luke chapter 4. I'm going to start reading verse 1. Luke chapter 4. Before I read, let me give a quick announcement. On tomorrow, McKay and I will be celebrating 24 years of marriage. If you really want to be technical about it, we can do 26 years and 8 months. That's a long time. God is good, and I am so thankful because I'm not the easiest one to live with. Some of y'all witnessed that yesterday, playing cards a little bit, and I can be a little mouthy. But I'm glad y'all left because Brother Allison.
Tell the truth!
Pastor Sutton and I kind of got it back. Y'all get to witness, we got a little whooping ourselves.
I bet y'all did.
But I hope y'all understand that, first of all, I understand that Brother A is not as thin-skinned as he be looking when I'm coming at him. And not only that, y'all may miss some of the words that he says to me.
That's a shame.
Brings out that other stuff. But there's nothing more that I like than have a group of people sitting around the table hoping that I lose. That motivates me.
Yes, it does. Amen.
So Steve came to the table. He didn't say a word. He just quietly whooped us. He didn't brag. He didn't boast. We was out there for a long time.
That's right.
Yeah. We shut it. I said, if Chael wouldn't have been with us, we'd have shut the party down. But we would have been there for a while. We left, what, about 5 minutes or 7 or 8? We're about to Anyway, I just want to get that out so y'all can know that Brother A got his revenge.
Amen!
That all of it. See, that's what. I'm a preach. I got, because the service, y'all, the service has been really, really, really excellent.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of things that have been said today, and I hope you all are listening very closely to what God is doing, and hopefully it'll go right along with, it does go, it absolutely goes with this word. I tried to type some notes, I'm trying to do better that, but I don't know if I'm going to be able to use this like I want to. Luke chapter 4, I'm going to read verses 1 through 13, and it reads, I'm reading from the Amplified Version, that's why I'm having y'all sit down, because it's a lot of words. Then Jesus, full of and controlled by the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan, and was led by the Holy Spirit. For during 40 days in the wilderness, the desert, where he was tempted, tried, tested exceedingly by the devil, and he ate nothing during those days, and when they were completed, he was hungry. Then the devil said to him, if you are the Son of God, order this stone to be turned into a loaf of bread. And Jesus replied to him, it is written, man shall not live and be sustained by on bread alone, but by every word and expression of God. Then the devil took him up to a high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time, in a twinkling of an eye. And he said to him, to you, I will give all this power and authority and their glory, all their magnificence, excellence, dignity, and grace. For it has been turned over to me, and I give it to whomever I will. Therefore, if you will do homage to and worship me just once, it shall all be yours. And Jesus replied to him, get behind me, Satan. It is written, you shall not do homage and to worship the Lord your God, and to him only shall you serve. Then he took him to Jerusalem and set him on a gable of the temple and said to him, if you are the Son of God, cast yourself down from here. For it is written, he will give his angels charge over you to guard and watch over you closely and carefully. And on their hands, they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone. And Jesus replied to him, the scripture says, you shall not tempt try it. Test exceedingly the Lord your God. And when the devil had ended every, the complete cycle of temptation, he temporarily left him, that is, stood off from him until another more opportune and favorable time. And God, that it bless you through the reading and hearing and doing of his word. Let us pray. Gracious Father, I thank you for your word, and I pray now for these next few moments that you speak through me, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in our sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
I'm sure we all have heard so many stories about Hurricane Harvey. And Harvey has done some devastation in Houston. And this tragedy, like, unlike others, I mean, I worry about people and all that, but this has really bothered me. More than usual, where I've been asking God, what in the world is going on? What are you doing? And y'all know when the way I was brought up, you shouldn't question God like that. You should just be cool and just do it. And I understand that, y'all, but sometimes you need clarity, especially when you're talking to a body of believers and we're serving a God who's so good and who's so merciful, and how in the world could he let something like that happen? And so, y'all, I'm still dealing with it, because I don't know if he's giving me a clear-cut answer. How many of y'all know that sometimes God makes you wait on some answers?
Yeah.
And sometimes you have to wait patiently
and
faithfully.
Yeah.
And waiting patiently and faithfully is not always easy.
Right.
And so I'm in that space right now where I'm waiting to really see, because I want to be able to give a word from God and not from Gillespie that will help us.
Yeah.
Be effective in our walk with Christ.
Amen.
So then, okay, so how does that lead you to this text and what are you talking about? Well, my title is I Must Come Forth. Can you all say that? But this is what I want you to do. I want you to, like, point at yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And I want you to make a declaration. Say,
I must
come forth.
Come forth.
Say it one more time. Say,
I must
come forth.
Come forth.
Now, I hope you all don't get it twisted, because that type of statement, you all just made a declaration, though.
Yeah.
You all just said that I must come forth.
Mm-hmm.
And when you say I must come forth, it could be an arrogant proclamation, mm-hmm. meaning you're saying, I have to come forth. Come on and see me. See how handsome I am. See how beautiful I am. See what kind of clothes I got on. See what kind of job I, whatever. I must come forth so folks can see me. If you're saying that, you're almost right. Because that's not the kind of coming forth I'm talking about. I'm talking about coming forth, and Dwayne hit it right on the head. We can talk about this man called Jesus. But if our lifestyle is not exemplifying something that lives on the inside of us,
yes.
we might as well be clanging a loud sounding cymbal.
Yes.
And we have no power behind what we're talking about.
Right.
But in essence, we must come forth.
Yes.
There ought to be some things happening in us that give us pride to come forth. I had a situation 2 weeks ago. September 16th, I was asked to play for a black party. You all. When I learned how to play the saxophone, it was nothing more than my mother making me play. I wanted to play the flute. I know y'all heard that all story already. I wanted to play the flute. She made me play the saxophone. I guess I took that she wanted us to be cultured, because I was an athlete, so music brings a whole nother arena of culture.
Yeah.
To your life.
Yeah.
Well, back in February, when I said I'm going to use every gift that I have to help the church, I'm going to start playing in sax. it's just to be obedient.
Right, right.
It wasn't to play at a black party with a bass player from the Sounds of Blackness, with a drummer from another professional recording group and another lead guitar player. I'm like, hold up. I'm like, for real? So I said I would help. So I'm trying to help. I'm getting to a point. Because while I was there, another band heard me play. They wanted me to come up and play with them while they were gonna perform at this black party. Granted, y'all, I had chipped my reed. If your reed is chipped, you cannot get a great sound because the air that you blow through this wood doesn't work. I'm gonna get to the text, I promise I'm gonna get there.
Well, you preach it.
They asked me to play with them, and then they had the nerve to ask me, would you solo while you playing with us? Any musician, if y'all been to any concert, the singers give a little time to the band.
Right.
You got whatchamacallit on the drum, you got him on the bass, you got him on the lead, and they all get the solo.
Right,
yeah.
Right, right.
That means they get to show off their skills on whatever song they play, but then they can vary off into a world of their own to show you how good they are.
Right.
They will, in essence, they will come forth
to show
what's on the inside of them.
Right.
I quickly and in a hurry say, man, I don't do that, and I will not play with you all. That's what I say. So when I got through playing with Redeemer, I put my sax up, put it in the case, and I walked out. Y'all already know what is going on.
Yeah. Yes, Lord.
God said to me, I told you to offer your gift to build my kingdom. And you, in your arrogance, want to limit my direction to what you want to use it for.
All right. Speak the word.
Now, I was going on my natural skill set.
Yes.
I haven't practiced what the praise and worship song Sister Art gives me, and she stretches me, absolutely, so I've been trying to practice a little bit. But after that, God said, you don't know what kind of doors I'm going to open for you with that saxophone.
So he said,
next time somebody asks you to solo, so next time somebody wants you to play impromptu, you better be ready to do it. Y'all, listen, I haven't played that in 15 years. I've been pulling it back out in February trying to help out. Now, folks, you never know when God is in need of you.
That's it.
When you have to come forth with something that has proven, that will prove your faith.
Yes.
What are you saying, Pastor? The text says Jesus, after being baptized, was led to the wilderness by himself. Y'all get that?
Yes, yes.
The Holy Spirit led him, but if we believe in the Trinity, he got led. To the wilderness by himself after he had fasted. Well, he was fasted for 40 days. The text said he was hungry. He was hungry. Point number one, God is going to lead us into temptation. Let me help y'all understand, because some of y'all don't get what I'm talking about. Crystal didn't understand. She said, Pastor G, they trying to give me a job, and all I got, I'm not even finished with my associate's degree. You need a bachelor's degree to get this job. Blah, blah, blah. Y'all know how she does.
Uh-huh.
I said, Crystal, what is God telling you? Is that what I asked you? And I didn't see her on the phone, but you know how y'all we can do on them hands. I could see her doing that because, number one, it didn't pay. First thing she said, this is going to take a big pay cut. I said, sometimes God leads you to a place where it's going to make you take a pay cut. He's going to lead you into something that looks like trouble. She said, I said, you know what God is telling you? Sometimes we want to get a billion signs.
All right, say it.
It's amazing. And I'm a Proverbs. I'm just amazing how some of y'all, God tell you to spend, when God tell you to spend your rent money on some shoes or a dress, hear what I say when God tell you to do that? It's amazing how quick y'all follow directions. Golly! It's amazing. But when he say, take a pay cut and go work with some prostitutes or some people who have not been cultured, or some people who are rough around the edges, and he's giving you some sandpaper, and you got to go rub somebody. And they gonna raise back up at you, and they not gonna always use Christian words. And you done took a pay cut, and you have to deal with their attitude. Something about that makes it difficult for us to say, amen, hallelujah, God, I am for you, I'll do it. What's going on? The text says Jesus was led into the wilderness, and the devil was there waiting on him to tempt him. Satan is waiting to tempt us. He's just waiting to tempt us. But sometimes God is going to push us into a place where you know it's crazy. Miss Netta tried to quit the club. How many times has Netta tried to quit the club? She keep trying to quit the club. I'm quitting. Woo! Pastor Lady got on my nerve for real today. I'm done. These folks don't know what I do. I am tired. But it's so funny because every time it ends with, God got me placed here for me.
Amen.
Amen.
That's right.
All that complaining. And she's legit. She had me complaining with her. I said, you know, y'all heard me say, Miss Netta, hey, you got my signature of approval, man, quit. It's ridiculous, they quit. But when God needs you to come forth, he's going to put you in a situation where you will be tempted, where you say all the stuff that we look around, all this stuff looks like there's no way it can happen. And I hear some of y'all saying in the spirit, well, he was God, he's Jesus, he's the spirit, he can handle all that. He had fasted for 40 days. He was weak, he was hungry. He probably had an attitude. The Bible doesn't say, but y'all know when we're hungry. I remember Dr. Austin challenged us to fast for 24 hours. I had never fasted 24 hours in my life. And then she old school, you know. How you want us to do it? She said, we don't eat nothing. We don't drink nothing. We just do it. Woo! Y'all, that was hard. That was hard for real. That's just for 24 hours. You know how we start justifying, we start looking on Google, how long can a person really be going on? When we're not as mature.
Right.
So it's easy for us to get in a wilderness when our maturity level is low, because really everything is a wilderness, if you understand what I mean. Because you're trying to live for Christ, so you're trying to do everything right. And because you're trying to do everything right, Satan knows that your confidence is shaky. This morning, Sarita talked, discipleship class for the first time. She did an excellent job. And what I like, what stood out for me about her teaching was, she said, as I studied the word, it came full circle for me. And I started to see some things in the text, because that teaching made her come forward. See, singing could be easy for her. Doing children's church may be easy. But when you got to stand up here and teach some folks who think they're theologically sound and smart, you know, I got to know how we got all these doctors and preachers up here, you know. And he may get a little intimidated. But something about that word, I believe, she got comfortable, because what I like about her, she got to talk about what the word meant to her. When you come forth, you don't have to worry about theological studies and commentaries to talk about your testimony. Nobody can tell you what you went through, because you went through it. And my story may not be your story, and your story may not be her story may not be his story, but they're all legitimate stories, because the process is, I'm coming out. And I got God on the inside of me, and he's going to empower me to be effective. So, I may not cross every T and dot every I, but I'm trying. But I'm not letting that be a hindrance for me coming out. Because the bigger thing is, man, I got to come out. You got to come out.
That's right.
You got to come out.
Yeah.
Full force. You got to come out. People got to see what you got on the inside of you. And you wonder, God, why you send me here? And why you send me there? What I want y'all to do is get to where you can just listen. It's important to listen. Jesus listened to himself. Because if he's a smart, all-knowing God, he knows he shouldn't go out in the wilderness hungry. But I believe he was trying to show us something in our humanness. Because I got another scripture that I wanted to read. I think I'm going to read it. Is that okay? Real quick, y'all. Gotta get out.
Hallelujah.
Read this on your own time, but y'all know this scripture. It's 2 Corinthians 4:8-10. Don't look it up, just listen. We are pressured in every way, but not crushed. We're perplexed, unsure of finding a way out, but not driven to despair. Hunted down and persecuted, but not deserted. Struck down, but never destroyed. Always carrying around in the body the dying of Jesus, so that the resurrection life of Jesus also may be shown in our body. What in the world is Paul talking about? Paul is talking about, these are the things that you may suffer while you're coming out. You may be cast down, you may be perplexed, but he always gives a hand. That means that is not a position that you will always be in. You may be broke right now. Boy, y'all don't ever make preaching that. You may be broke, but you can say, well, I'm not really broke, because my Father in heaven has everything that I need, and he sustains me. In the process of coming out, it's going to be some times when you feel like you are naked. That means you don't have any battle, you don't have anything to go to war with. But God is saying, you got everything you need, because you got me living on the inside of you. Because you got me living on the inside of you, you are unbeatable. Y'all know why I talk so much junk when I play cards. I don't think, now this is my thinking, I don't think in my mental that anybody in this world can outthink me on a card table. I really honestly believe that. And I'm going to take every advantage that you give me.
Yeah.
Charles and Brother A so frustrated. They was arguing with each other. They wasn't really fighting, you know, they wasn't showing out because, you know, you're not going to do that in front of the Saints. But if the Saints really wouldn't have been there and they could have just been buck wild and said what they really wanted to say, oh, I would have been laughing like crazy. I knew I had them when Uncle Charles said, I'm going to take my books and you take your books and we're going to see who really make it what they did. They were frustrated. And y'all know what I said? I said, oh, look, Charles, you make more than Brother A. Brother A didn't make what he made. He didn't make what he did. Oh, I am frustrated. Woo! Every little thing that did, Brother A said, man, you're something else. Can I tell y'all that that's what Satan does to us?
Yeah.
He looks at every little piece of us. And he, if you can give him a little hole, he gonna jump in it.
Oh, yeah.
He asked Jesus to to bow down to him. He had the nerve to say, I am the prince of the earth. So if you bow down to me, I can give you all this. Satan is trying to give Jesus something that he can't give him. He's also saying he can give, he's lying, number one. Then he's giving something to Jesus that Jesus already got. Satan's trying to sell y'all some stuff that he can't sell you. But you don't understand. You don't understand the process of coming out that you will already have what he said you can't have. Expecting one thing. You know how she is, and you probably know how she is. She's probably gonna say, well, because I did this, and this. They probably done some research on you. Because folks will Google you in a minute.
Yeah.
Man, somebody said, I Googled you, and I saw this one. For real? Y'all ain't Googling you. They even can get it so they can find out if you got some court stuff, and then you pay a fee. But y'all know it's nosy people that want to bring us down.
Yeah.
And they will do stuff like that. To hold you back, but that's what Satan does. But you have to be like I am. You have to think, the devil cannot out-trick me. I am too well versed in living for Christ. There is a confidence that's necessary for you to come out, because you're coming out to be a blessing. Go back to Texas for 2 minutes. I'm thinking about people who have bought boats from all over the country to go to Texas to rescue somebody.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking about the racial tension that's going on in America.
Yeah.
And to go to rescue somebody in a place that sometimes you've never been. You don't know if it's a white neighborhood, a black neighborhood, Latino. You don't know where you're going. You're just going to put your boat in the water and go help somebody. Right? That's right. I believe when people are going down there to save people, they don't care if they're saving a white person or a black person. They don't matter. All they know is somebody needs to be saved.
That's right. That's right.
We have to realize that somebody needs to be saved.
Yeah.
And that we have to come out so somebody can be saved. We have to come out so we can tell somebody how good God is. We got to come out to tell them, you can make it. You can make it because I made it. God has no respect to purpose. So we all in this thing together. Texas is breaking some racial tension.
Yes,
it's causing people to look past themselves.
That's right.
Yeah. If you haven't wondered this, I think I'm like, God, can a flood happen in Minneapolis? But guess what I say then? Because I come to discipleship this morning, we're talking about the flood. And we're talking about an almighty God who needs to communicate himself to people. So anything can happen anywhere. All he has to do is say it. So that means the laws of nature. Whether the earth is flat or round, God can do whatever he wants to do. And he can make something happen wherever he wants to happen. So you're not protected from a disaster.
That's right.
So we have to be mindful of that.
That's right.
But the bigger thing is I want you all to be, even if something disastrous happens, we have a great big old God who cares about us, who wants us to know that we have the victory. Jesus used the text back on him.
Yes, he did.
And I believe, let me do these last two. I believe the mountaintop, y'all, he jumped down, called the angel to catch you, all that stuff. Come on, man. Satan's funny.
Yeah.
But sometimes we get on the mountaintop. Uh-huh. And we think we are that. Mm. That power. Y'all know power? Okay, power's intoxicating. Yeah. When you get to the mountaintop, I say that's when you're the most vulnerable. Because when you're up there, you know, it's all good. Then Satan come with these lies, and then we eat it up. So when we're up high, when we're in an immature state, and lastly, he comes to the temple. He came to the temple, and he asked Jesus to bow down and worship him. What nerve. But hopefully that communicates to us that Satan will come up in here and ask you to bow down to him. And hopefully you all will say, I am not bowing down. Because God doesn't want to have any other God before him, and I'm not going to bow down to worship him. I hope y'all hear what I'm saying. There was a request that was made by my wife, and I'm going to honor that. I've been thinking of doing something. We're going to take an offering for Natricia Orr, who's in. She's still there right now? Where's she at?
She left to Dallas because of the stress of the situation.
But bring me an offering tray. We're going to do this real quick. We're going to take an offering for her. I don't care. Y'all, listen, let me tell y'all something like I always tell y'all. You got to put nothing in here.
That's all right.
But see, the way we trust God, whatever we send, God can multiply it and triple it and quadruple it, because that's what he does.
That's right.
I was in the laundromat one time, y'all, when I was in college, struggling. I know I had about $7 in my pocket. Y'all hear me? $7. God said, give it to that lady over there. She had about 10 kids with her. I took the offering, took the money out of my pocket. Now, y'all know how we do, just put it in her hand. And I walked off. But I looked back for some reason. Them kids and that lady was jumping around, running around that laundromat like I had given them $100, whatever. I believe God took my little $7.
Yes, he did.
And when I put it in her hand, I know y'all too deep. Y'all don't believe that stuff like this. I believe I put that money in her hand, and God did something miraculously with the money that I put in her hand because of my heart.
Yeah.
I couldn't give what I wanted to give. But if I would have had, I would have. But I believe he did something because I didn't.